In the Red File tonight, one man's powerful, redeeming journey out of poverty and neglect as seen through the eyes of his wife. While growing up in a trailer park called Cloud Nine, Rick Sylvester endured unimaginable suffering, abandoned by his father when he was only two. His mother, who was often absent and drunk, introduced him to crystal meth and exposed him to a world of abuse and despair. Just one of many painful and disturbing recollections from his life story reads, Rick and his sister Jenny shared one double bed in that room, often at the ages of just 4 and 5. They were left alone all night or deep into the night, wondering when their mother would come back. Sometimes she would be gone for days at a time, and the kids would stay huddled in the motel room. Rick ultimately escaped that life when he was 18, but the road to recovery was a long and arduous one. He battled depression, anxiety, PTSD along the way, and often used drugs and alcohol to self-medicate until he was diagnosed with bipolar disorder later in life. And today, Rick is a loving husband and father. He was able to overcome adversity and hopelessness, but he couldn't have done it, he says, without the grace of God. Now, he and his wife, former National Review writer Ericka Andersen, friend of mine, are sharing his story in Leaving Cloud Nine, the true story of a life resurrected from the ashes of poverty, trauma, and mental illness. Book is out today, and Ericka joins me now. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
So at a time when we are bombarded by tragic stories in the news, suicides, depression, children being ripped away from their parents, war, this is not an easy read. It's not necessarily an escape from all of that, but it is a story of redemption and faith. And if you can get through it, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Talk about your decision to tell this story.
Yeah, that's why we wanted to write this book, because Leaving Cloud Nine is really, you know, it is a story of redemption and hope. And, you know, you look right now around this country and we have a drug crisis going on, and there are thousands and thousands of children who are experiencing some of these same things that my husband went through. Yeah. You know, you just read through a list of some of those things and they're awful. And, you know, there's this thing called adverse childhood experiences, and that's a very technical term, but there are 11 of them, just kind of key things that kids can go through as a part of childhood trauma. Well, my husband went through 10 out of 11 of those things. And, you know, the result of that is physical and mental problems later in life. I mean, imagine coming out of childhood and try to navigate the world as an adult when you haven't really had anyone to show you the way.
Right.
So we thought it was so important to kind of offer up his story as a template of hope for other people who are maybe trying to come out of that themselves.
Well, yeah, a lot of people are embarrassed or ashamed of past battles with depression or suicide or drug abuse. Was it hard for you to get your husband to tell that story? Or was he really, you know, interested in finally sharing that, maybe getting it out there?
Yeah, you know, originally it was his idea. The book was his idea, which is super interesting. People are always surprised when I tell them that, because, you know, he would tell me these stories as we were getting to know each other, you know, 8 years ago when we met. And I said, you know, your life just sounds like a book. And, you know, I just feel like, how did you overcome when so many other people would just be caught up in that cycle of addiction and poverty? Yeah. And, you know, he could have just become a statistic. And instead, he has this rare story of overcoming. And so he wanted to tell the story because he had been in such an emotional pit of despair at one point. And now, you know, he came to this place of freedom and healing. He just wants other people to have that too.
Right.
And so he just thought, hey, if I can tell my story in this book, great. Of course, we never thought we would get to the point where it's out on the shelves at Barnes and Noble talking to you. But we're thrilled that it is, because we think that we really can offer hope to people.
I'm wondering if people might be inclined to compare this to Hillbilly Elegy. I see some familiar refrains. Is this also trying to tell a story of economic and sort of social collapse of a forgotten voice in America? Or is this really just sort of one man, you know, your husband's story?
Yeah, absolutely. So when I read Hillbilly Elegy, I was kind of in the middle of writing this book, and I thought, man, there's so many similarities here. And I thought, this is such a great example of how it's not just, you know, in the Appalachian country, you know, Ohio, Pennsylvania, the places that J.D. Vance wrote about. Yeah. You know, this is happening all over the country. You know, my husband grew up in Arizona and Colorado in the West. And so it's not just in, you know, these isolated areas. It's nationwide that we're dealing with these problems.
Yeah.
And so I think it's good that we're having these conversations, and there's a lot that needs to be done in order to combat this crisis and, you know, help kids that have gone through these kinds of traumas.
Well, It's a really powerful story. The book is Leaving Cloud Nine, The True Story of a Life Resurrected from the Abuse of Poverty, Trauma, and Mental Illness. Ericka Andersen, thank you so much.
Thank you.